We have gathered here again this year for the first interaction between students and teacher. This kind of program has found a great acceptance and popularity among the students in the microbiology, because here basically we are dealing with the problems and their solutions faced by the students in their practicals. Because there are many lectures in which the theories have been discussed, but as far as the practicals are concerned, students have certain difficulties, and we try to solve around 30-40 questions which they face during these kinds of sessions. So I will not be taking more time, but I would like to introduce to you my colleague, Mrs. Kiran S. Trivedi. She is also from the same college, R.G. Shah Science College, and had a wide experience in microbiology. Today we both will try to give answers to our best capacities regarding the questions which will be asked by the students. Again, I am repeating, these questions are specifically restricted to the practicals only, and the theoretical questions will not be discussed in this session. To start with this, I will ask my students to initially introduce themselves and ask the questions one by one. So first, let us start the program. The first question will be discussed, or it will be asked by Jhalak.
Myself, Rathod Jhalak from R.G. Shah Science College. Why Wilson layer medium supports the growth of Salmonella species?
Well, Jhalak has asked regarding the Wilson layer agar medium supporting the growth of Salmonella. Now, the answer to this question is basically can be explained in a way that Wilson Blair's bismuth sulfide agar medium, this is the complete name, Wilson Blair bismuth sulfide agar medium, is the selective and differential medium which permits the growth of Salmonella species of the organisms. If you see the important ingredients of this medium, then it has got, apart from the normal ingredients like meat extract, peptone and other things, two important ingredients which are very much distinct to this kind of medium is bismuth sulfite and brilliant green. Now, both these medium together, both these ingredients together, they help to suppress the growth of gram-positive organisms as well as coliform groups of organisms. This medium is specifically meant for recovery of Salmonella organisms from stool sample from a patient. So, stool sample contains large number of coliforms, and therefore this medium suppresses the growth of coliforms. At the same time, the bismuth sulfate is an indicator dye, or indicator salt rather, I would say. Salmonella group of organisms, they produce H2S, and it forms a metal sulfide, bismuth sulfide, which is black in color, and therefore the colonies obtained will be having a black color. While those organisms which do not form a black colony, that is, they do not produce H2S, their colonies will be green in color. So this is how the Wilson Blair bismuth sulfide agar supports the growth of Salmonella species. Next question.
Hi, my name is Shraddha Tulade. How do we identify the bacillus in
The question from Shraddha from Rajkot is, how do we identify Bacillus cereus from nutrient agar plate? This will be answered by madam.
Okay, actually we all understand that during the isolation of bacteria, you must have studied the colony characteristics of different kinds of microorganisms, especially you had seen the colonies of cocci, bacilli and short rods. In case of bacilli, you know very well that the colonies are very typical in the sense that they are flat, opaque and they have very irregular margin. But when you talk about the Bacillus cereus in a speciality, we should understand that their colonies are having some rhizoidal growth, and on the basis of those rhizoidal growth we can identify the colonies of Bacillus cereus on nutrient agar plate.
Next question.
Why cross matching is required for blood transfusion in case of same blood groups?
Before I answer the questions, I would like to request the students to speak bit loudly on the mic and keep the mic very close to their mouth. So this will be very clear, otherwise it will not be audible to the students when it is broadcasted live. So Samir, your question is, why cross matching is required even if the blood group is same? Now basically, prime thing that is necessary during blood transfusion is that blood group should be matched. Well, this is the first aspect that is basic to the transfusion of any blood. That is, a blood group should be matched properly. But apart from that, it is also mandatory, or it is advisable, to have a cross matching too. Now, cross matching between what? Then the cross matching is between the two individuals, that is donor and the recipient. Now, there are two types of cross matching which are being performed. One is major cross matching and the other one is minor cross matching. In case of major cross matching, recipient serum is tested with the donor's packed cell, that is the donor's RBC. This is to done to determine the presence of antibodies in the recipient serum. And the second one, that is the minor cross match, is vice versa, in the sense that recipient's RBC, recipient's red cells, are matched against the donor's serum. This is basically done, but in few cases it may be avoided, in the sense that the donor's antibody which are directed against the patient's antigen is very little, in the sense that the amount of antibodies, it is assumed basically that amount of donor's serum contains very little amount of antibodies, and therefore it is sometimes avoided also, or it is not done. The next question.
From MD Science College. My question is, what is the mode of heavy metal on inhibition of microbial growth?
Yes, madam, please answer this question. What is the mode of heavy metal on the inhibition of microbial growth?
Okay, fine. Actually, again, if I talk about the effect of heavy metals, which you have already studied in SYBSC practicals, you must have observed that just surrounding the copper coin, you can see a zone of inhibition, and after the zone of inhibition, you can also see the zone of stimulation. The reason is that actually these metals, they inhibit the growth because they can inactivate some of the enzymes. Not only that, but sometimes it has been observed that these heavy metals in higher concentration can precipitate the proteins of a cell. As a result of that, the cell is being inhibited, and we see this kind of inhibition.
Well answered, madam. The next question.
Hi, I am Belani Jamin from SM Panchal Science College, Talud. My question, if atypical coliforms are indicator of fecal contamination was present indicates the presence of pathogens, then why atypical coliforms are considered bacteriological analysis of water?
Well, Mr. Jamin, I am right. Basically, whenever we are performing the bacteriological analysis of water, we are interested in finding out whether the coliforms are present or not. Specifically, we are worried about the E. coli. Is that organism present in water? If at all it is present, that indicates the presence or there is a possibility of other pathogens of human origin. Now, in order to do this, we perform presumptive, confirmed and completed tests. These three tests as a whole are known as presumptive tests. Now, in case of confirmed test, basically, First presumptive test is done, then later on confirmed test and completed test. Many times, if the test is positive, presumptive test is positive, then we go for a confirmed test. And in confirmed test, basically it is what we do is from a positive presumptive test tubes, we strip EMB agar plate. Now what happens is that in certain circumstances, non-coliforms or coliforms other than E. coli, they also tend to grow and form a colony which are considered to be something like atypical. Though these are coliforms, they tend to form the colonies which is similar to atypical, that is colorless colonies. And therefore, to be more safe, we also take into consideration atypical colonies and we proceed further. So to be on a safer side, these kinds of exercises are done. It is advisable. Well, I hope you have understood the answer. Next question.
Hi, I am Sejal Rupalya from MG Science College. My question is, what is flash presumptive test, why it is obtained and how it is prevented?
Madam, she is asking you what is false presumptive test and how do you get this false presumptive test in a presumptive test and how it can be prevented.
Okay, Sejal, I will answer this question in a way that we had already performed the bacteriological analysis of water. In that, you understand that the qualitative analysis of water always consists of some test, as for example, presumptive test, confirmed test and completed test. Now, presumptive test sometimes can be a false positive presumptive test. What is the reason for that? Actually, you know that presumptive test is given positive by coliform group of organism. But sometimes it is very much possible that some organism can produce a synergistic effect. That is, synergistic means joint action of two organism on a carbohydrate to produce acid and gas, and this is basically seen in case of Proteus and Staphylococcus aureus. If these two organisms are present together, they can ferment the lactose with the production of acid and gas, and we can wrongly presume that coliforms are present. Hence, this is called as false positive presumptive test. And this false positive presumptive test can also be removed or prevented by addition of bile salt in the McConkie's lactose bile broth medium, which is already added. So this is how we can prevent the false positive presumptive test.
Next question, please.
Hi, my name is Kalpesh Swarathya. I am from Ajisha Science College. My question is, gives names of organisms forming swarming colonies other than Proteus vulgaris.
Well, basically, first let me explain to you what is swarming. Swarming is nothing else but on a moist nutrient agar plate, or you can say non-inhibitory medium, certain species of the organisms, they having the flagella and having an active motility, they grow very rapidly and spread into the medium in a profuse manner. To be more accurate, swarming is shown by Proteus vulgaris in a sense that it forms a concentric rings of the growth. This is basically due to the phase variation in case of Proteus organisms, whereby one is the expansion phase and the other one is the consolidation phase. Expansion phase will have the swarm cells, which are later on differentiated into vegetative cells, which we call them as a non-swarming cells or ordinary cells. These kinds of alternate cycle continues. It leads to the formation of concentric rings on the plate and the colonies will grow very large. Now, this was the case of a Proteus. Apart from Proteus vulgaris, other species of the Proteus, specifically like Proteus mirabilis, also forms a swarming colony. But if you look to the other genera, then we have other slime bacteria. We call them as a myxobacteria. These organisms, they also form a swarming growth. The example of one of the myxobacteria is Myxococcus xanthus. These organisms also form a swarming type of colony. I hope it satisfies you. The next question.
Good evening. Myself, Sonam Priya from Arjisha Science College. And my question is, why green metallic sheen is observed only in E. coli and not in enterovector aerogens on EMB?
Well, madam, please answer this question.
Okay, well, actually you people are quite aware of with the medium like EMB. Actually, full form of EMB is eosine methylene blue agar medium. This medium is a selective and differential type of medium, and this is especially used to differentiate the E. coli from enterovector aerogens. In this medium, we are making the use of two dyes like eosine and methylene blue. Now, one thing which is very important to understand over here, that E. coli, when they uses the lactose, the amount of acid produced by them is very high as compared to the enterobacter aerogens. So naturally, when they produces a large quantity of acid from the lactose, this causes the precipitation of eosin and methylene blue. Actually, this precipitation leads to the formation of a greenish metallic sheen, which is not found in case of enterobacter aerogens. The reason is that they produces the less quantity of acid from the lactose. So I think the answer is quite clear to you.
Well explained, madam. The next question, please.
My name is Gadara Jalpa from Gyan Yagna College. And my question is, how nigrosin helps to restrain from cytoplasm during spore staining?
Jalpa, you must be knowing that we perform the spore staining. It is a kind of a special structural staining by different methods. One of them is Dorner's method, wherein the cells are stained by ZnCF. Now, when you use the ZnCF, it is natural that it is a strong stain, and we also use various intensifiers during this staining procedures. As a result, the vegetative cell as well as the spore itself gets stained. And after the first step of staining, both vegetative cells as well as the spore are pink in color or red in color. Now, if you want to see a distinct spore, then it is necessary to remove the stain from vegetative portion of the cells, and therefore this can be done either by decolorizer, it can be an alcohol, or it can be a simple water where you can keep your slide in a running water for a longer time. And even a nigrosin, which is negatively charged stain, can also act as a decolorizer. Nigrosin has a property that when it is spreaded on the slide, it will remove the ZnCF stain, that is basic fucsin, from the vegetative portion of the cells. And finally, what we get is a red spore, vegetative cells colorless, and the background black. Okay, so this is the answer to the question. Next, please.
Can safranin?
Yeah, please go ahead.
Can safranin used as a primary stain in gram staining instead of crystal violet?
Yeah, ma'am.
Okay, actually, again, this is a very basic staining method which we are using in our practicals. And as you understand, that majority of the bacteria can be stained by using the basic stains. Normally, the basic stains are used to stain the bacteria. In this case, safranin is again a basic stain, but we cannot use this stain in gram staining. Do you know the reason for this? Any reason for this? No, actually, the reason is that crystal violet should be used because it can form a very good complex with the iodine. CVI complex will be formed when we are making the use of crystal violet. If we are using the safranin, then this kind of complex will not be formed. Hence, we are not using safranin in place of gentian violet in gram staining.
So, the thing was a bit very simple, but the answer was very tricky. Madam has justified that. And the next question, please.
What is the role of mannitol in nutrient media like S-base mannitol agar and yeast extract mannitol agar?
Thank you. Basically, when we want to grow certain soil organisms, specifically nitrogen fixers, mainly symbiotic and asymbiotic. For symbiotic, that is rhizobia, we use yeast extract mannitol agar, and for non-symbiotic we normally use ash-based mannitol agar. Now ash-based mannitol agar is again a selective medium where there is no source of nitrogen in the plate, and therefore it will be only those organisms who can fix the nitrogen from the atmosphere will be able to grow. Now the question, basically answer to the question, why mannitol is being used? The reason is because it is an inherent capacity of both these organisms, that is Azotobacter and Rhizobia, to use mannitol as a source of carbon. Mannitol can be utilized easily by these both these organisms, and both these organisms, they have ability to form capsules also. So this sugar is used by these organisms and converted into the polysaccharide too, apart from using it as a source of energy and for their carbon. So that is why mannitol is considered to be a good source, and it is incorporated into the medium of ash-based mannitol as well as yeast extract mannitol. Next question, please.
What is bacteriostatic and bactericidal?
Okay. Actually, so far we have studied the effect of different kind of chemicals on the growth of bacteria. And from this, you must have understand that many more times we see the inhibition. Now, it is not necessary that all different kinds of chemicals, like suppose if we take the examples of phenol, crystal violet or HgCl2, it is not necessary that all of these chemicals will always show an inhibitory effect. Some of them can show the inhibitory effect, whereas some of them can show a killing effect. So if a chemical is showing an inhibitory effect on the growth of bacteria, we call that chemical or that chemical agent as bacteriostatic. But if that chemical kills the microorganism, kills the bacteria, we call that chemical as bactericidal. So this is a basic difference between these two things. One is a bacteriostatic, inhibiting the growth of microorganism, the bacteria, and second is a bactericidal, that is killing the growth of bacteria.
Next question, please.
My question is, what is mean by dilution factor?
I would request students first of all to introduce themselves, just to give their name and then ask the question. I think this was asked by Bhumi.
Yes.
From MG Science College. Well, Bhumi, dilution factor basically is nothing else but the reciprocal of the dilution which you have performed during the experiment. Now, dilutions are performed in many practicals, specifically during the quantitative estimation of proteins, sugars, or even it is performed when we want to dilute our bacterial sample or the inoculum. When the inoculum is very high, naturally we do not get the well isolated colonies. Actually, during standard plate count, we require around 30 to 300 colonies, and therefore when we consider that the sample is unknown, it needs to be diluted so that at least in few of the plates we get the number of colonies between 30 to 300, and therefore dilution is necessary. Now this dilution is can be either tenfold or 100-fold or 1000-fold. That is depending upon the original sample, how dense it is. The dilution can run into up to a million times also. So depending upon how much dilution which you have performed and plus the amount of inoculum plated into the plate. So reciprocal of both these has to be multiplied with the answer which you are getting. For example, if you are getting 200 colonies or if you are getting say 91 colonies, dilution of the sample was 100 times, then it is 91 into 100, and if the amount inoculated was say 0.2 or 0.5, let us say, then it has to be multiplied by 2 in order to get the number per ml. So this is how the dilution factors are being used for various experiments. I hope, Bhumi, you are clear now?
Yes, sir.
Next question, please.
My next question is, which organism are used that index of fecal pollution of water?
He is asking you, organisms which are considered to be an indicator of fecal contamination. Ma'am, please.
Okay, now drinking water, quality of drinking water is very important, and it should never be mixed up with some fecal material. So naturally we have selected some organism which can be used as an indicator of fecal pollution. One of them which is very commonly used is E. coli. The another one is Streptococcus faecalis, and one more is Clostridium perfringens. These are the three organisms which can always be used as an indicator of fecal pollution.
Next question, please.
My question is, what should be condition for a pigment product for any microorganism?
Again, I am requesting you. Who was the one who asked the question?
Yes, sir. What should be?
I want the name, please. Your name.
Sejal.
Sejal. So again, I am requesting you. Please introduce yourself and then ask the question. So, Sejal, your question is conditions necessary for pigment production. Now you know that pigment is a very important characteristics which helps in identification of the organism. Sometimes rather going for any other biochemical test, we can outrightly identify the organism on the basis of its pigment also. Say for example, growth of Serratia marcescens, Staphylococcus aureus, or even Pseudomonas. At least up to genus level, we can definitely say that this is the particular organism. Now in order to get a good pigmentation, there are three prime important conditions. First one is that the medium should be rich. Rich in the sense that it should have all kinds of nutrients. And preferable medium is the media like milk agar medium and even media like glucose or rather not glucose, yeast extract agar medium, where the yeast extracts will provide them all kinds of growth factors. Milk, you know, is a very good medium for any kind of bacteria. It also has all kind of growth factors. So a good nutrient-rich medium. Second one is the temperature. The temperature required for any pigment production is normally a room temperature. In India, normally temperature may increase, room temperature may also increase to 40 or above that. But for a good pigment production, we would say a temperature in between 25 to 30 is considered to be an ideal temperature for the growth of the organisms. So these two important things, and third important thing is the density of the organisms, because in many cases that pigment production is basically not the capacity of a, or it is not a property of an individual bacteria, it is a something like a property which is exhibited when the cell density increases or goes beyond a certain number. So it is necessary that if you have a dense culture or a large number of organisms, then pigment will be easily visible, or the organisms are able to form a pigment in a very better manner. Next question, please.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Kalpesh Soretia. I am from Arjisha Science College. My question is, what is importance of MIC?
Yes, ma'am. Please answer this.
Okay, Kalpesh, before knowing the importance of MIC, it is very important for us to understand what is MIC. Actually, MIC means the minimum inhibitory concentration. Minimum inhibitory concentration means any antimicrobial agent which can show the inhibition of microorganism in its lowest concentration, or it is the highest dilution of any antimicrobial agent which can inhibit the growth of microorganism is called as minimum inhibitory concentration. So in short form we say it is MIC. We call this as MIC. Now coming to the point, that what is the importance of MIC? As you know that basically whatever the diseases or the infection occur in a human being, always they have been treated with some antimicrobial agents, especially the antibiotic. Now in what concentration the antibiotic should be given so that the patient is free from some infection or from some diseases? So how to decide this thing? In this cases, the MIC plays a very important role, because if you know that what is the MIC for any pathogen, then you can always decide the dose of the antibiotic which could be given to a patient so that the patient gets rid of those kind of infection. And normally it is a 10 times more than the normal MIC which we have observed. So the dose should be 10 times more than the normal MIC which we have seen would be useful in the treatment of infection or in the treatment of diseases.
Well, madam, nicely explained, in the sense that the correlation between MIC and which is basically in vitro test and the decision to administer a dose to a patient for a recovery is basically in vivo. So there are lots of complications.
Yeah, the concentration should always be high.
So she has explained it very nicely in a very simple terms. Next question, please.
Good evening. Myself, Sorum Priya from RG Shah Science College. And my question is, why detection of coliform is done in water?
Well, Sonam, detection of coliforms from a drinking water is always done before it is distributed to the public. This is done by the microbiological lab or a sanitary survey or health department. Now, this is done basically to ensure that a potable water reaches to the public. Potable water means the water which is, as far as microbiological criteria is concerned, we will discuss that only. It should be free from other pathogens. Now, since human beings suffer from various gastrointestinal disease, and large number of these organisms, pathogens, are being shedded every day in thousands and millions from the stools which an every individual would pass. Now, the E. coli is also a normal flora, basically, of any colon of a human being. And thus, E. coli is also released, or it is also shedded in millions of amount from every human being when he passes a stool. Approximately, the amount is 10 raised to 8 organisms per gram of stools. So, it's a very large number. And therefore, rather than searching for different kinds of pathogens, our work would be easy if we are able to detect only coliforms, that is the E. coli. If we are able to find E. coli, then it is assumed that there is a fecal contamination, and to be on a safer side, please avoid that kind of water because it is non-potable. There is a possibility of presence of pathogens. So this is the reason, and there are no doubt various other reasons, but this is the prime reason. Another important reason is coliform is found in a very large number, and therefore, even if there is a slightest contamination, we'll be able to detect the coliforms. So these are the two prime important reasons. There are several more because they are easy to detect, easy to grow, non-pathogenic, and so on and so on. So I hope this is what you have followed, Sonam. Next question, please.
Myself, Gadara Jalpa, and my question is, differentiate between proteolytic and saccharolytic reaction.
So, ma'am, Jalpa is asking you, what is the difference between proteolytic and saccharolytic reactions?
Okay, Jalpa, the answer is very simple. Actually, when we say proteolytic reaction, that means the reaction which are based on utilization or metabolism of proteins, the reaction based on proteins. And when we say a term saccharolytic, that definitely indicates that the reactions which are based on utilization of carbohydrate. So this is the one difference. Second thing is that in proteolytic reaction, the end products are alkaline, whereas in saccharolytic reaction, the end products are acidic.
Next question, please.
Myself, Rathore Jalak from RG Shah. If antibiotic inhibits the growth, so why they are harmless for our body?
Why antibiotics, they kill bacteria but not harm the human beings? Very simple. Bacteria are prokaryotes, human beings are eukaryotes. Not only human beings, animals, plants and other things are human. They are all prokaryotes. So this major difference, that is difference between prokaryote and eukaryote, is considered as a principle of selective toxicity. Selective toxicity means we can only use those chemicals or antibiotics which will kill one particular pathogen but will not harm the recipient. Recipient is normally either it can be a plant also, it can be animal also, and it can be human being also. So if human being is the recipient, means if the person is sick and if he is given the antibiotic, then that antibiotic should not harm the patient itself. That should not be harming the human being. Rather than that, it should harm the pathogen, it should kill the pathogen or inhibit the pathogen. So this is the basic difference. Whenever we are selecting any particular chemical compound or antimicrobial, you should know that it should have or it should exhibit a selective toxicity. If a compound is not showing selective toxicity, it may be able to kill the organisms, but at the same time it will be able to kill the cells of the recipients also. So in that case it is not advisable. These kinds of antimicrobials are being used for the treatment of cancer, because in cancer, cancerous cell itself is a eukaryotic cell and our body itself is a eukaryotic cell. So you must have observed during many cases, in case of cancerous patients, that when a particular antimicrobial or when a particular chemical compound which is a inhibitory for the cancerous cells is given to the patient, then patient also suffers a lot, because he himself or his cells, there is a loss of appetite, there is a loss of weight, there is a loss of hair. All these things are side effects, but you can't help it in those cases, because it has to be treated under any circumstances. But as far as microorganisms and other normal diseases are concerned, it is always advisable to take selective toxicity into considerations. And therefore, antibiotics are miracle drugs. They kill the pathogens, but does not harm the human beings because of their selective toxicity. Next question, please.
Myself, Qureshi Samir, and my question is, Candida albicans causes infection in mouth. Where does it found and how does it identify?
Samir, Candida is basically a yeast. It is a dimorphic fungi. Dimorphic means it shows two kinds of morphology. That is mycelated form also. That is, we call it as a pseudomycelium, and a unicellular structures also are observed many times, and that is what we call it as a yeast-like structures. So Candida albicans is a kind of a dimorphic fungi. Now it causes two kinds of diseases very commonly occurring in human beings. One is the oral thrush and other one is a vaginal thrush. So it is a genital disease and the other one is the oral disease. Now in both the cases, these organisms can be identified by taking a swab from the throat or from that genital region and observing it microscopically. If we find the organisms, gram-positive yeast-like organisms, then we proceed further. We grow them on the media like blood agar medium, and when the colonies are formed, the germ tube test is also performed, whereby the colonies are picked up, it is suspended into a serum containing glucose, and after a few hours a germ tube is observed, which is visualized by microscopy. So this is how the Candida albicans is identified and it is diagnosed. Next question, please.
Good evening, I am Bhumi Valecha from MG Science College. My question is, what is the difference between acid fast and gram staining?
Yes, madam, gram staining, acid fast staining, both are differential staining. Please explain them in detail.
Okay, actually, Bhumi, very nice question. Normally, whatever the staining techniques you might have done in SYBSC, you must be knowing that you are quite familiar with the gram staining. But as far as the acid fast staining is concerned, sir has already answered you that both the staining are actually differential staining. But in case of acid fast staining, we differentiate between the acid fast organism and non-acid fast organism. Whereas in case of gram staining, we differentiate between the gram positive organism and gram negative organism. Now, what is so important about the acid fast staining, which makes it very better or important as compared to the gram staining? In case of acid fast staining, basically this staining is done to find out the presence of Mycobacterium tuberculosis, who are responsible for TB. So diagnosis of the TB can be made by performing the acid fast staining. That is a better advantage over the gram staining.
Thank you, ma'am. Next question, please.
Myself, Velani Jamin from SM Panchal Science College, Talod. My question is, describe the technique used for identification microorganism of by at enzymes activities.
Jaimin from Talod. Well, let me tell you that in order to identify any organism, it may be a human being or plant or animal. If let us say example that if an elephant is there in front of you, you will be directly saying or you will be shouting that this is an elephant. Why? Because you know his morphology. It is large enough to see and large enough to identify that it has got two large ears. Its morphology is known to you, in short, and you will be easily able to tell them. But what about microorganisms? Microorganisms are too small to visualize. You have to take help of microscope. And that too in a microscope, you cannot do much rather than telling that it is a bacilli, cocci or short rods. So what we have to do is, we have to go for its anatomical testing. That is, you have to dissect the cell and see it inside. Now again, that is difficult. So what is the alternative? Without dissecting the cells or without going inside the cells, you have to find what is inside the cells. So what is to be done is, you have to check for its various enzymes present. And this can be done by either providing a product to the cell and see its disappearance, or whether it is still there, it is not utilized, or it is utilized by the organism. And the second thing is to check the products which are formed. One is, you provide the substrate, whether it disappears. If it disappears, it means it has been used. Either you check that. Or second one is, you check the products which are formed. If the products are formed, it means a particular enzyme is present. So in order to test and identify, various hundreds of biochemical reactions are there, by which we can identify what is there inside the cell, whether this cell possesses a particular enzyme or not. If at all it is there, whether it is functioning or not at present. So on the basis of these various enzymes present in the cell, you can identify. Various enzymes present in cells will help us to identify. So the basic role of biochemical testing is primarily based on these aspects. Next, please.
Myself is Sejal Ruparelia from MG Science College. My question is, which type of chemical and physical intensifier are used for spore staining and why?
Yes, ma'am. Intensifiers and their role.
Okay. Actually, in case of a spore staining, you must be knowing that the spore is basically a very dormant type of structure, and it consists of different kinds of layers. Multi layers are present in the spore. Hence, the staining of spore is very much difficult. As for example, if I tell you the spore consists of a spore coat, it consists of a cortex, it consists of an exosporium. Because of all these multiple layers, it is very much difficult for us to stain the spore. Hence, we have to always utilize some of the techniques which should enhance or which should permit the staining of the spore. So, in this case, we are making the use of heat as an intensifier, that is a physical agent, and we are making the use of ZnCF dye, and ZnCF is a very strong dye because it contains phenol. So again, phenol is a chemical intensifier. So in short, I can say that the heat is a physical intensifier and phenol is a chemical intensifier being used in the spore staining.
Well answered, ma'am. Next question, please.
My name is Kalpesh Patel. I am from Arjisha Science College, Ahmedabad. My question: how fermentation products used for identification of bacteria?
Well, my answer to this question has already been answered to certain extent in the previous ones, where your role of enzymes or identification of enzymes and its role in identification of the organism. Same case is here, that when we use the fermentation in a broader sense, it means that any reaction whereby a cell forms some product. So those products are known as a fermentation product. This is basically in a layman's language and day to day what we speak about the fermentation. So fermentation product, when we are using it for the identification, what I understand by this question means that production of indole from the, that test is known as the indole production test, production of H2S, production of certain acids, and detection of acids in by different methods, say for example MR test, or by Huygens-Lifsens medium, Huygens-Lifsens test, or by ordinary inoculating the organism into a glucose broth or lactose broth. So in short, any fermentation products, basically they are formed if the enzyme is present in the cell, and if this enzyme is present, the substrate given will be broken down to its product. These products are the product of what we call it as a fermentative reactions. Don't take it literally in the sense that fermentation in literal sense will be different thing. But in common sense, we call it as a fermentation reaction. Organisms break down this substrate, leads to the production of a product, and that product can be identified by either adding some reagent or by adding certain chemicals which gives the visual reaction. So this is how the fermentative products helps in identification of a bacteria. Next question, please.
Myself Sonam Priya from Arjisha Science College, and my question is, why EMB agar medium is used for confirmed test of chloroforms?
Sonam, I think this answer has been answered to certain extent earlier, but madam, please just tell her in short.
Okay, in short, I will just tell you, Sonam, that basically EMB is a medium on which we can always differentiate the E. coli from Enterobacter aerogens. And E. coli, as you understand, that they produces a greenish metallic sheen, whereas the Enterobacter aerogens, they produces the colonies which are pink, large and mucoid in nature. So this is basically a differential medium to differentiate between the typical and atypical coliforms.
Next question, please.
Myself Gadara Jalpa from Gyan Yagna College, and my question is, what is standard Planck count?
You mean standard plate count, SPC. Standard plate count basically is the method of counting the number of organisms present in a given sample. It may be water, soil, food or any other sample for that matter. Now, why we call it as a standard plate count? Because this is a very standard procedure, and where the plate size is standardized and number of colonies which are to be counted should be always be in between 30 to 300. So, by that we get the number of organisms which are able to grow in that particular medium in that given environment. Be careful, the number which we obtain is expressed in form of a colony forming units, that is CFU per ml. But this number may be too low as compared to the original picture, that is the actual number of organisms present in the sample. Because there are lots of limitations of these kinds of methods, in the sense primary limitations, two major limitations are that all organisms cannot be grown on a one single medium. Different media will be there for different kinds of nutritional requirements of different organisms. And second important thing reason is that no one set of environment is conducive for all organisms to grow. So different organisms, psychrophiles will have to be incubated at lower temperature, thermophiles should be incubated at higher temperature, osmophiles will require a high salt concentration or sugar concentration. So with all these limitations too, we are able to find out the load of normal organisms or mesophiles growing in a routinely used media like nutrient agar medium. That is known as a standard plate count, and still it gives you a very good idea how many organisms are present in a sample. And this will help to take you various decisions, whether to sterilize or whether to treat that water or to discard that kind of food sample. Thank you very much. Next question.
I am Jalak Rathod from Archisha Science College, Ahmedabad. Which types of fungus grows on bread?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, Jalak. The fungi are the one which can grow anywhere if the atmosphere is very damp or it is very moist. So in case of bread, you can see different kinds of fungi like rhizopus, mucor, aspergillus and even penicillium, but provided that the bread should be placed in a very damp and moist environment.
Next question, please.
My name is Shraddha Tolaria from Gyan Yagna College, and my question is, what is MPN test?
MPN test, again, it's an important test in order to determine the load of organisms in a given sample. Don't be under confusion that MPN is only done for water. MPN can be done for any number of organisms. What is required is the type of medium according to the nutritional requirement of the medium. So, for example, if you want to do an MPN of chemoautotrophs, then you will have to select the media, appropriate media in which these chemoautotrophs can grow. Now, basically, MPN stands for most probable number. It is a kind of test where we take into consideration a principle of dilution to extinction. That is, we prepare different dilutions, or if we don't prepare the dilutions, we inoculate the organisms into three sets, whereby 10 ml, 1 ml and 0.1 ml, or it can be the decimal fractions of these. It can be even 0.1 ml, 0.01 ml and 0.001 ml. So any kind of combinations can be selected, but it had to be three sequential dilutions. That is important thing. And basically it is based on a statistical analysis which is called as a Poisson distribution, whereby the total number of positive and negative tubes are taken into considerations. Not only positive tubes, if you take a positive tubes, then naturally out of a particular set of tubes, negative tubes will be known to you. So we take into consideration positive and negative tubes, and then we look into a McCarty's table, which is basically a kind of a log, something similar to log table. We can directly get an answer from that log table. Now basically that table uses the formula whereby MPN per 100 ml is equal to number of positive tubes, that is number, how many number of positive tubes are there out of set of 5, into 100 divided by the root of ml of sample in negative tubes, that is how much amount of sample you have inoculated in negative tubes, and ml of sample in total number of tubes. So this is the basically the equation whereby you can come to a particular number. So this is what we call it as an MPN test. So dear students, we have taken into considerations approximately 30 questions, and due to the constriction of time, limitations of the time, we have already discussed these things for 1 hour, and we are not in a position to take other questions because the questions will always arise in a fertile mind as you pay more and more attention to the practicals. As you get yourself involved into a practical, it is very natural for a good student to have lots of doubts, lots of queries. As a result, he has to come out very openly and frankly with the teacher concerned and keep on asking why, how, what, and all kind of questions, which at times may feel to a teacher that it is a question which is something like a nonsense question. But still, please be open and always have guts, or don't have any fear to ask any doubt to your concerned teachers. Because if these doubts are clarified at this stage, that is in the beginning years of your career in microbiology, then your concepts will be very clear and you will be able to engross yourself and you will be able to understand the subject very nicely. I am telling you from my personal experience that expertization in a practical is one of the very good necessity for a further studies. Even it will help you in your research work also. So thank you very much, students. I also thank Madam Kiran Ben, who has helped me in answering and solving the queries of these students. And last but not the least, I would also like to help or thank the various institutes who have sent their students from such a distance. How can I forget the helps from the BISEC crew, all persons in the control room as well as handling the camera have been very efficient in recording as well as bringing this program live to you. And I am also thankful to Sandhan, BISEC and Commissioner of Higher Education for taking initiative for such a nice activity.
Even I am highly thankful to the students who had come over here and I could interact with them. I wish we could have prolonged the time, but anyway, time is a very important factor. So we finish it off over here, saying and wishing all the best to all of you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you, madam.
Good luck to you.